to shine. Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness. It's shining. Would you sing about this this morning? Shine, Jesus, shine. Lord, the light.
Thank you. Shining for thee, sweet.
No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of glory and worthy of honor and worthy of power and of praise. Sing it. No other name.
Pharaoh has sent you. I am that I am. And we mentioned that that also could be translated, I will be what I will be. And so throughout history, throughout from the history in the Old Testament, all through the New Testament, and into today's age, we see Jesus. Jesus being who he will be. And Jesus said when he was on earth, I am the light of the world. Aren't you thankful for the light today? Isn't it great to have a light shining for you and for me and guiding us and doing all the things we're going to talk about this morning? But we're so glad that Jesus is the light of the world. He is who he is. He will be who he will be. He is the name above all names. that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's go to prayer this morning. You can be seated if you'd like to be. And we want a special prayer request this morning for Janice's mom, Kathy, who's in the ER right now and is suffering with dementia. And we want to just lift her up in prayer today and this family right now, and along with all the other needs we have represented here today. Let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful today for who you are. We thank you for who your name says you are. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you that when he was born, the angel declared that his name would be called Jesus because he would save his people from their sins. That's us. His name Jesus means he will save us from our sins. And we have eternal life today because of who Jesus is and because of what he will be. God, I just thank you and praise you today for your presence in this place. We thank you for your watch care over us. We need you every moment of every day, and you are with us every step of the way. The Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And even if we stumble, you uphold us with your right hand. And that is such a great promise for us today, to know that you are with us wherever we go. God, we just want to thank you and praise you for the opportunity to be in this place this morning. We pray for those who are worshiping with us today in spirit through the technology of the internet, who are perhaps watching by video at a later time. We pray, Father, that you would just join us together with you by your Spirit, because your Spirit transcends all locations. Your Spirit transcends time. You go beyond everywhere and everything. And we thank you for that today. Lord, you know the needs that are represented in this room today and in these homes that are watching. You know the concerns we have. You know the loved ones who are suffering. You know the ones who have had tragedy. You know the ones who have suffered bereavement. And you know the ones, Lord, who are going through struggles in their lives, either spiritually or emotionally, sometimes in marriages and relationships, and physically, Lord. We know that you are able to do all things. And in fact, you already know the end from the beginning. And you know the outcome of all these concerns we have. It gives us great peace to come to you. It gives us great confidence to know that if we ask anything in your name, you hear us. And if you hear us, you grant us the petitions we ask of you. Such confidence no one else can have but those who trust in you. And we come to you today with these needs. Lord, I just want to lift up especially Kathy, Debbie's mom. Lord, you know all about her. You know everything's going on in her life. You know what's happening right now in that emergency room. You know about the hospital and the treatment she's receiving. And Father, we would ask you today to just touch her, Lord, and with this need that she has. And God, I would pray today that you would be with her family members who care for her and stay with her and help her through this difficult time of her life and for their lives as well. Because dementia has a great impact on people because of the way the mind doesn't work anymore. And so, Father, we just want to pray for this family. We pray that you'd be with them. Give them peace today. Give them hope. Give them encouragement and strength. Lord, we would ask you to be with all of those of our number who are in need. We pray for the continued healing for Mary and for Gary in his heart situation. We pray, Lord, that you would be with all of these ones who are dealing with situations that are ongoing. We pray, Father, that you would bring healing and strength to all of these ones. Father, we live in a country that needs you right now. We pray for those in authority over us, as your word has instructed us to do. We pray for our president and for his cabinet. We pray, Lord, for members of Congress. We pray, Lord, for the decisions that are being made right today and this week, Lord, as decisions are being made that affect all of us. And we pray for your will to be accomplished. Draw men and women who are in these positions to seek what is best and what your will would be. We pray, Lord, for our armed forces, wherever they are. Protect them, we pray. Lord, I pray for our missionaries, that you would encourage their hearts and help them to see fruit of their labor. We pray for the local churches around the world, not only in our own country, in our own community. We pray for our churches in Newcastle, Lord, that we are not a part of them because they go to different locations, but we're all part of the body of Christ. And we pray, Lord, for those in other countries as well who are worshiping, maybe not at the same time now because of time differences, but they're worshiping you today, and we pray for them. We pray, Lord, for the persecuted church. Lord, we just ask you, God, to be with these ones. Be with these ones who are suffering because they name the name of Christ. God, we want to thank you for who you are. Again, we just praise you. You are so worthy to be praised. No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of glory and honor and praise. We worship you and thank you so much for allowing us this opportunity to be with one another in our homes or here in this church and to share this time together. Draw us close to yourself during this hour, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen.
Year for, I would dare say, all of us, has often seemed like one very dark, long season. But there is a light. Thank you.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And Jesus is the light of the world. He is. He lightens our path in many, many ways. We'll be having a prayer gathering again this Wednesday night here at the church. We're going to try to start having the first Wednesday night, a night where we can come together and pray. We're just going to come and pray. No music, no sermon, just a time of prayer. I mean, we encourage you to come, and we can be socially distanced, and we can join together in prayer in this room, and we encourage you to come on Wednesday night. We met in February, had a good time of prayer together. Who doesn't agree that we need prayer, and this world needs prayer, we're starting to see things getting better with this virus. If you listen to the right people, they start to tell you that maybe by May, we might start seeing some immunity going around and all that kind of stuff. And maybe there's just light at the end of the tunnel. There's that word light again, isn't there? Light at the end of the tunnel. So if you're able to come Wednesday night, we encourage you to come. If you can't be with us in person, at least pray at home, and we appreciate that because God hears all prayers. And you'll notice in the bulletin today there is a calendar. Haven't seen one of those for a while, haven't you? You know, our secretary here has been behind it, got to get it done here, but we're trying to get this out. And so if you're not familiar with our calendar, on that calendar, there's a name in every date, on every date. There's a name, at least one name. If it's a birthday, it's indicated by BD. If it's a wedding anniversary, it's indicated by WA. But if there's no letters beside it, it's just because we're going to pray for that person that day. And I ask you to just take that calendar, stick it on your refrigerator or someplace, and just pray for that person every single day, on that day. And one of the things that I think would be helpful in the time of disconnection, we're not connected as we used to be because of the COVID, maybe if you feel led, call that person on that day and just touch base with them, or drop them a line or something like that. Not have to do it every day, but if you feel led, Lord prompts on your heart. I remember Bill Hybels used to say, and he wrote a book about this, about God whispering. If you get that little whisper, a God whisper, respond, because it might be just the time that person needs to hear from somebody. And so we encourage you to do that as well. So we're hopefully going to try to keep the calendar coming on a regular basis. And if your birthday occurs in March, and it's not on there, before you get upset with me, just let me know, okay? I'll put it on for next time. We know that there are new people to the church, and we don't have all the dates. We've asked for them several times, but it's hard to get those in. So if you just call the church office, if I'm not here, leave a message, call me directly, call my cell phone, do something so we can get that list up, because I want to have everybody's included in this connection tool we have. So let's do that as we go. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles, if you have them with you, or a device of some kind, or follow along as we read. We're going to look at the book of John for our primary passage this morning, and two passages in John, the first chapter, and then also the eighth chapter. And we will be referring to other verses that I won't be reading right now, but if you have your Bibles open, you can follow along and stuff like that. In John's Gospel, in the Gospel of John, we find probably the most information about Jesus and who he is. It's in John's Gospel that he gave these seven I Am statements we've been covering during Lent. These are the statements to tell about who he is and what he will be, as we've been mentioning already this morning. And also, it gives us ideas about how he came, why he came, who he was. And so it's a good book to read. And in the first chapter, we have many things about him. And beginning with verse 6, this is what it tells us. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. In John chapter 8, verses 12 and 13, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. The Pharisees challenged him. Here you are, appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid. Let's pray. Father, again we ask you to guide our thoughts as we consider your word as it was written, as you inspired the writers to be penmen and share these inspirational thoughts with us that you've given them. Your word is God-breathed, is poured out for us. Help us, Lord, by the Holy Spirit, to apply it to our lives and be closer to you as a result. Thank you for your word. Thank you for what it means to us. Thank you that it is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The gospel is good news, isn't it? That's what the word gospel means. It means good news. And the saddest commentary in the Bible is that the gospel was rejected and continues to be rejected today. Here in our passage we read this morning, it says that Jesus came to his own people. He came to those that were his own, meaning that he was born in the Jewish nation. He was born among the Israelites that we read about in the Old Testament. And he came to his own, and yet, as we see in the New Testament, they rejected him. They did not receive him as they should have. And today, that continues. There are so many people today that are lost. People today who will not see heaven because they reject Jesus Christ. They reject the one by whom they must be saved. They just turn away. The Bible tells us in the first chapter of John, just prior to what I read already, that in him was life, and the life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The darkness has not conquered it. Another translation says the darkness has not understood it. He came to his own. He came and shone the light in the darkness, and yet the darkness did not see it. Light is an immensely powerful metaphor. Light is used in many, many, many ways. It depicts openness. If you do something in the light, or you shed light on something, it's out in the open. Knowledge has been depicted by light, and we have the absence of being weighted down by burdens as described as being light. And every religion employs that metaphor to light to describe their deity. When a concept is discovered, people say they have been enlightened. And some of the Eastern religions focus on enlightenment as their mantra. We often say that a light has been turned on. Years ago, there was an advertisement that Ford had a better idea. Remember that? Ford had a better idea. When they showed the commercial on TV, there was a light bulb in the corner that would kind of click on. Remember? Because a light came on. The light shines. As Sandy sang the song this morning, the Bible is described as a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. The life in Jesus was the light of all mankind. And then Jesus comes out and actually says, I am the light of the world. And he also taught his disciples something else that we're going to talk about this morning. He said, we are. He told the disciples, you are. We are also the light of the world. And that's one of the few times that Jesus took one of his attributes and employs it and shares it with us. I am who I am. This is what you should tell the people. I will be what I will be. And so, throughout the Bible, we see him revealed. Jesus told the people in his day that if they knew him, they would know the Father. He said, he is the light of the world. It is who he is, and it is also what he will be. He will be that to you and to me every day. Let's consider just a couple things about these passages that I've shared. One is that Jesus was the light of all mankind. I think about this. It's kind of, you kind of think about this in a way that when Jesus came into the world, he didn't come into the world for a select few people. When the Bible says that God loved the world so much, he didn't just love a certain segment of society. God loved the entire world. And Jesus came to the entire world for all mankind. And if you're sensitive about gender language, all womankind as well. He came for all of us. He came that we might be enlightened. He came that we might receive the light, that we might receive life, because that life that he brought is the light of the world. And it talks about John here, and it's interesting that we bring this out in this first chapter of the book of John because, you know, John happened to be a relative of Jesus. They were related because Mary and his mother were cousins, they believe, and so John would have been also related. And John was born first. He was a forerunner, so to speak, of Jesus. He was a witness to testify concerning the light. And so when you follow the scripture in the Gospels about John, you see John as being kind of an unusual guy. He dressed funny. He wore camel's hair and he ate wild locusts. And I can just picture this guy being pretty scruffy looking. And out in the wilderness, and he didn't have any qualms about calling out. In fact, he got in trouble, didn't he? Because he called out the wrong relationship that the Tetrarch had with Herodias and all that kind of stuff. And a result of that, John was beheaded later on. So he was pretty bold. And he came out and he preached and he baptized in the wilderness. And in that process of doing these things, he made it clear that he was not the one on which the focus should be placed. At one point he says that I am not worthy to even untie the sandals of the one who is coming after me. This Jesus, this Messiah, This one who is coming is the one to focus on. John was not the light, but his purpose was to be a forerunner of the Messiah. He came so that through him, through the ministry of John the Baptist, all might believe, and that his ministry pointed them to Jesus. He pointed his own disciples to follow Jesus. He pointed them to the true light. And so we see that Jesus was the true light that gives light to everyone. Jesus was the one. Jesus is the true light. Some people have difficulty with the idea that Christianity proposes that there is no other way to heaven but through Jesus Christ. But it's true. The Bible says that. And if there are many, many paths, and they're all equally successful, then why do we bother worrying about it? We can just follow our own path. But the mission of the church is to take the gospel to everyone, to go into all the world and preach the gospel, to make disciples of Jesus. We need to do that. Jesus was a true light, and yet it tells us in these passages we read that the world did not recognize him. Now, I've said this before, I tend to try to put myself in real time in Bible stories. I don't know if anybody else does that or not. I'm probably weird. It's probably something I do that is kind of goofy, but when I'm reading the scripture, a lot of times I will just kind of put myself in the context of what was there. Because, you know, a lot of times when I've read the Bible, I've thought that the Bible characters we read about were kind of like the only people around. But it's not true. I mean, when Noah built the ark, there were thousands of people that were opposing him, and he died in the flood. When we talk about the Israelites crossing the Jordan River under Joshua, they didn't go into a wilderness area. They went into inhabited cities by people, and they had to conquer them. They were not the majority. In fact, they were in the minority. When Jesus came to this world, and he called his 12 disciples, and they went out, they taught. And yeah, like last week we talked about, they had a lunch for 5,000 plus people. Where did they come from? They were people inhabiting the earth. And as they came together, they heard the words of Jesus, and they couldn't take the words. They said it was too hard to accept. And they walked away. The world did not recognize him. And this is the tragedy. Not recognizing Jesus for who he is and acknowledging what he has done for us has eternally tragic results. Do you know anybody today who has rejected Jesus? Of course you do. There are many. There are many who want no part of this stuff. No part of Christianity. No part of the church. No part of the Bible. Don't give me that Jesus stuff. I want no part of that. How tragic those statements really are. Because the day is coming when he will say to them, "Sorry, I never knew you. Depart from me into outer darkness." It's a tragic thing when people do not receive and recognize Jesus. And the idea that he came to his own were the Jewish people, the people who should have understood. They had all of the enlightenment of the Old Testament prophets.
that all the teaching that was handed down from them from generation to generation, they should have known all about this Messiah. The prophecies of his birth were fulfilled, and yet they did not receive him. And among those chief who did not receive him were the Jewish leaders, the religious leaders. See, religion doesn't get you anywhere. Religion, if we depend on religion, it will fail us, because religion in many ways is man-made, and it's what we have made of who God is. And if we look at our religion as our salvation, we miss the boat. Religion, someone said, is spelled D-O. It's what you do and have to do and have to keep doing. But relationship, as Christians, is spelled D-O-N-E. And that is what Jesus has already done for us. And it makes a big difference, doesn't it? We don't have to achieve things to become saved. In fact, there's nothing we can do to earn our salvation. It's by grace through faith alone. Jesus has given us and done for us all that needs to be done. So he came to his own. It says in the Bible that we read this morning that his own did not receive him, but those who did, he gave them the right to be called children of God. And that's a tremendous truth for all of us today. For each of us here today who have received him as our Savior, he has given us the right. He has given us the claim to be called children of God. And we can say proudly, we can say authoritatively, we can say it with conviction, I am a child of God because I have received Jesus as my Savior. The second thing we see in here is that Jesus made the declaration. And as I mentioned earlier, we're talking about these different declarations he made, these metaphors that tell us about him. When he said, I am the bread of life, it opened up a whole new realm of understanding about who Jesus was that we considered last week. Today he says, I am the light of the world. He asserted his claim to who he was and what he would be to the world. He continues to be the light to the world in which we live. If only the world would recognize him as such. We mentioned about the rejection of the world today. You look about us and we see that so much. In fact, it's not just people who have rejected Jesus. People have become oppositional to Jesus. And they attack Christians and Christianity. We're seeing it more and more today. It's something that we need to watch out for. We talk about the persecuted church. We talk about those. And I know that we mention that a lot here, and I've believe that it's important that we remember them. You know why? Because someday it may be us. Or we become very, very complacent. We become very, very much accustomed to having the freedoms we have. But we've seen a taste of it this past year. We've seen a taste of it for a while. That we were not allowed to meet in groups. And we couldn't worship together like we are today. That's been tempered throughout the regulations of our particular state. But in some states, it's been much worse. And it's been something that's been readily accepted. What happens if something else happens a year or two from now? Another virus. Are we going to be back in the same boat? We'll come to the point where they say churches don't need to exist. They're not essential. Depends on who is
in authority, we need to watch for that. That's why I think it's so important that we pray for those in authority over us. If you don't pray for President Biden every single day, and pray for the government, and pray for those who are in authority over us, don't have to agree with the policies, but the Bible says pray. The Bible says pray that we might live peaceful lives on the earth. And that's what we need to do. So Jesus makes the claim that he is the light of the world. And we read that whoever follows him will have the light of life. This truth, what we're reading here, gives us great promise. Perhaps even more so than what we talked about last Sunday. We have a promise that we who follow Christ will have the light of life. What does that mean? He says we will never walk in darkness. We'll never walk in darkness. Now, I don't need to say this, because I don't think anybody here in this room lacks the knowledge that would make you believe this, but I think sometimes we need to be reminded of the difference between literal and figurative language. When someone says we will never walk in darkness, it does not mean that we won't go through the house someday with the lights turned off and stub our toe on the kitchen table, right? It doesn't mean that we'll never need a flashlight when we go outside on those dark nights. It just means, figuratively speaking, that we will never walk the path of living our lives without the light that Christ gives. That's why it's so very important for us to be in the Word of God. I stress, reading our Bible every day should be so natural. It should be something that we would not fail to do as much as we wouldn't fail to brush our teeth or eat breakfast or do other things that are in our routine. Make it a part of your routine to where you're spending time in the Word, because His Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. The psalmist has said that. It's true. And so, what we see here in this exchange between Jesus and the Pharisees is that Jesus made a claim, and he testified to that claim, and the Pharisees had a problem. They took issue with that. Remember last week, the religious leaders had a problem with Jesus saying he came down from heaven. How can we take him down from heaven? We know your mom and dad. We know the carpenter shop. How can you say you come down from heaven? It took issue with that. And here they're raising another issue and challenged him because he said this of himself. He testified of himself. And Jesus responded to them in verse 17 and 18 of chapter 8. In your own law, it is written that the testimony of two witnesses is true. I am one who testifies for myself, and my other witness is the Father who sent me. Whew. Did he just throw gas on the fire? Because now he's saying that his Father witnesses and bears witness of who he is. We've already read that John the Baptist was a witness of who he was. Others have witnessed to that. But Jesus claims that himself is a witness and the Father is a witness. And that did not set very well with them. In fact, these are the things that led to the opposition of Jesus. They wanted to kill him. They wanted to get rid of him. This was radical teaching. And Jesus said to them, if you had known me, you have known the Father. And there is a connection here that's very, very important. So, we see that Jesus not only said he was the light of the world, but he also passed that on to you and me, his disciples. And back in the book of Matthew, when Jesus was giving us what we call the Beatitudes, the happy is he's, the blessings, the ones that Jesus was saying about how we should live and what that would mean, he said that you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. We've already mentioned that light has a lot of applications in metaphors. Being enlightened. The light coming on. A lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Light cannot be hidden. Light is a very interesting thing. And those of you scientists know all of this much better than I. And you also probably relate to it better than some. But you cannot contain light. You can't put it in a box. What happens if you put light in a box? It's not there. You can't be in a dark room if there's a light, however small it is. You can light a candle in a dark room, and you can see it from a distance, a flickering light. But light dispels darkness. Light has no shape or form. You really can't hold it in your hand. Can't put it in a box. And so Jesus said to his disciples, and that includes us because we are also his disciples, that we are the light of the world and we cannot hide that light. In fact, he says people don't put it in a bushel, under a bushel. They don't put it in a box or under a bowl, however you want to describe that in the various translations of Scripture. Instead, he said you put the light on a stand. You put it up high where it lightens the whole room to everyone in the house. You know when the power goes out and you have to use the little lanterns or those little candles? You know, that's what he did. I used to love when the power go out of room. I used to love that. You know why? My dad worked second shift all my life. He was a nighttime guy. And when I came home from school at night, he was at work already, and when I went to bed, he was still at work, and when I woke up in the morning, he was sleeping. And I'd see my dad on weekends. But when there was a thunderstorm and the power would go out, he made us wake up and come downstairs and be together and put our shoes on in case we had to run outside. Every thunderstorm had to put your shoes in your jammies, put your shoes on. And he liked the oil lamp or candles. And it was so cozy being there with Dad. Because we were together. I hated when the thunderstorm ended. I hated when it went away. And, okay, back to bed. And we had to leave. Jesus says, you put your light up on a stand and it gives light to everyone else. We are to let our light shine before others. And just like John the Baptist pointed others to Jesus, we are also entrusted to point others to Christ as well.
I think it's significant, and I thought about this a lot this week. It's significant that on this particular statement of Jesus, the declaration that he was the light of the world, he passes that off to us too. We're not the light. We reflect the light. He is the light. He doesn't take away anything away from him. But he tells us that we are to act like that. We're to be the light of the world to those around us and let our light shine in the darkness. Darkness signifies the evil environment that's around us. There is a sphere of evil out there. You know that. I'm not telling you anything new today. It's not something I have to share with you, because you know, as you go through life and you watch the news and you live in society, there's darkness out there. The sin is real. And people find themselves in that darkness. Darkness represents the forces of evil which seek to snuff out the light. They seek to destroy the good. They seek to silence the church. They seek to counteract Christianity. In John chapter 3, verse 19, it says that they loved darkness rather than light. And there are a lot of darkness lovers out there. There are people out there today who are so much in love with darkness that they just thrive on it and don't want anything to do with the light. God said, I am that I am. I will be what I will be. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. Southeast Christian Church in Louisville, Kentucky has this huge sanctuary that seats thousands of people. I've been there, we've been there. It's a massive place. In the lobby, there are these huge escalators to go up to the upper levels. I mean, you know, go to church and you're going up escalators. It's a while. But it's so big that sometimes birds get in there. And the facilities department has the job of trying to figure out how to get rid of those birds. I'm sure if we had birds flying around the building today, it would kind of be like distracting. And it would be distracting if one of them happened to drop their, you know, droppings on us. Shooting the birds wouldn't work. That wouldn't be a good idea. And poisoning them would probably be considered inhumane, and they'd probably have a lawsuit by some environmental group. The goal is not to destroy the birds, but to save the birds and to free them. So this is what they did. To save the birds, they turned off all the lights and made it as dark as possible. Then at one of the lower exits, they opened the doors and they made it as bright as they could with the outside lights. The bird instinctively flies to the light and escapes. We look around and we see things getting darker and darker, don't we? Oh, a lot of our conversation is how dark things are getting in this world. The longer we as people do not come to Jesus, the darker and darker things become. And in that darkness, the brighter Jesus will shine, and the stronger our instincts to come to him will be. Do things look dark? Are things getting darker in your life? The darker things get, the closer we need to be to him who said, I am the light of the world. Who Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Let's pray together. Father God, again, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for opening it up to us by your Spirit. It was written so many years ago, yet it's living. And it applies to us where we are right now. Help us today as your people to walk in the light, to be able to be drawn to the light. And Lord, also we pray, help us to be the light to those around us, to shine our lights, not so people see us, not so they are drawn to us, but that they will be drawn to you. We pray, Father, that you would help it to be so. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a song we all remember singing as a child. In fact, we sometimes separate songs in the church, like there are kids' songs, Sunday school songs. Jesus loves me, this I know. There's no greater song with greater theological truth than that song for adults. We can relegate it to a child's song. And some of the kids' songs we sing, they might be little simple songs, but you know, if you stop and think about them, they say a lot to us. And one of those kids' songs that we used to sing is, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine." We have all hand motions and all that kind of stuff, but we don't have to do the hand motions. But I'd like for us today to close our service by reminding ourselves that we are the light of the world, and we have a light, and we're going to shine it, okay? So if you'd like to stand with me, and we sing as we close, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine.
Precious day. Amen.